I thought you did a terrific job on the FSU story. Very enlightening, and I think it answered a lot of questions that Willie Taggart was probably hoping somebody would answer. I'll get to him in a minute. But let me start with Jimbo Fisher. Has the Fisher camp responded to you at all? Is there, for people that haven't seen the story, Matt's story essentially had FSU folks essentially saying, Jimbo left this thing a mess and Willie's trying to clean it up. Has there been a response of any sort from the Jimbo camp?
None yet. I will say this. The thing is with Jimbo, I tried to track him down for like a month and a half.
Right.
And the sports information guy there, Alan Cannon, is one of the best guys in the business. He knew what I was writing. I told him, from day one when I was writing, he tried to get Jimbo. I basically had to go from California, where I was out working a story, to fly to Destin for one last shot at getting a hold of him, because I knew he'd be at the spring meeting for the league.
Right.
And I knew he'd be milling around there, so I'd have to get him at some point. And I caught him in the hallway, and he was, very much, I don't want to talk about that. I had a good time at Florida State. We left good players. That's all he wanted to say. So he had the opportunity. I heard from someone close to him in the last day that his response was essentially, well, he tried to get a hold of me, and I told, and I didn't respond, so that's my fault.
To the story. Clearly, from reading your story on Bleacher Report, obviously Jimbo let the thing get out of hand. He wasn't making people go to class. There wasn't much accountability. They weren't held to a standard. They should have been his people and his students. But the big part of the story was it all started with his allowing Jameis Winston to be so entitled. That was very interesting, Matt, that FSU people didn't deny that. They kind of allowed, did they not, that Jameis had the run of the place, and that's when it all started going downhill.
I can tell you this. I talked to three different guys that are on staff there, and all of them said it was a lot worse than what you publicly think it was. A lot worse than him arguing with Jimbo at the goal line before the Clemson game when he shouldn't even have been out on the field. I think what happens, and again, Frank, this is not unique to Florida State, because this happens at a lot of big programs where you've got elite stars. They kind of get a lot more leeway than other people. But I think this one was taken to another level because all three of those assistants said that was the turning point, that moment in the Clemson game, before the Clemson game, when he's out there in full pads working out when he shouldn't have been on the field, and then he's arguing with Jimbo at the goal line. Now, one of those guys told me, look, man, he should have just said, get off this field. Don't come back to this facility for a week, 2 weeks, 1 month, whatever it is. And if you lose him, you lose him, but you've saved your program. And I think a lot of that is his point was, other players see that. They see him getting away with things. They see him arguing with the voice at the top. No one should be arguing with the voice at the top. It should be, okay, fine, I'll do what you say, I'm gone. I'll go back and like whatever. And he was arguing with him. And their point was, when other players see that, they then begin to think, okay, well, if I'm better, I can do those things. And I can push him. I can push the envelope. And let's see what happens when I push the envelope. And slowly, over the next few seasons, that's what happens.
Hey, Matt, I thought it was a tremendous story as well. And my biggest takeaway from it is, here you have Jameis Winston, who led Florida State to a national championship, won a Heisman Trophy. But this is the sort of thing that really, it seems like, could permanently damage his legacy with the school, because I think Seminole fans are reading this, and I think they're agreeing with the point of the story. And do you get a sense that there will be a wedge between Jameis and Florida State as time goes on? Because as the further we get away from his era, more things come to light about, what kind of a player he was sort of off the field.
Well, Hayes, I, the first thing I want to do is, I don't want to minimize what Jameis was at Florida State as a player. He was a generational type player. You win 27 straight games. It's phenomenal what he did and where he led them and how he put them at not only the top of college football, but in the same breath as Alabama. So I don't want to minimize what he did. Football player, he was unbelievable. But I certainly think that there will be Florida State people that look at it differently. It's not really unlike Hayes, the Urban Meyer situation at Florida. They're very similar with what Jimbo and Urban did as they left those programs. And I think the further you get away from what happened in Gainesville, I think the more people start to recognize, you know, what Urban brought them. It doesn't mean they're okay with what he did and how he left and how he left the program, but they recognize what he did athletically, wins and losses on the ledger. And I think at the end of the day, years down the road, that's going to be what's more important. But I certainly see short-term what you're talking about. There will certainly be people who will not be happy with James.
To that end, will Jimbo have a bad mark in the FSU in Seminole Nation? I mean, the Urban thing's really interesting, Matt. Gator fans, I don't think, know what to think of Urban Meyer. I almost sense there's more negativity toward Urban than positivity, yet he brought him two titles. It's a weird deal. What about the Seminoles and Jimbo as you see this thing?
You know what? I think it'll be similar. It'll be similar. I think the only reason it won't be as bad as Urban, because I think with Jimbo, it wasn't, I have to retire because of medical issues, and then a year later, I'm going somewhere else. Jimbo just flat out was like, look, I don't want to be here anymore. I'm going to Texas A&M. They're going to pay me $75 million. What idiot on this planet would not take $75 guaranteed and walk away?
Right.
So I think it's a little different in that respect. I truly believe, Frank, that Florida fans were upset because they feel like Urban lied. They feel like Urban said, my health issues are an issue, and I need to get out and go take some time away from football. And before even the calendar turned to a year, 10 months, he was already signing another contract with Ohio State saying it was his dream job. And I think that, as much as anything, especially after what Florida was going through early on with Will Muschamp, kind of really scarred Florida fans.
Matt, from being with Dave Coburn, the new athletic director at Florida State, you've always believed that Willie Taggart will get the third year no matter what happens this fall. Did that opinion cement itself in talking with Dave? And were there any other tidbits that you know came out from your talks with Florida State's athletic director of interest?
Well, I'll say this, Hayes. I'm convinced more than ever that he's going to get year three. I don't care what happens this year. Now, again, that doesn't take into account something that could happen away from what happens on the football field that could easily turn public opinion. You know what I mean? Like if something crazy happens with one of his players, they're in trouble, or something has happened in the 2 years he's been there that's been an issue, that becomes an issue with the NCAA or something like that, then a 5-7 record absolutely would be a problem. But I mean, the way things are going right now, I don't foresee anything like that. I just, they're very excited about where they're headed. You know, and Willie was very honest about it. Number one, he made mistakes. He absolutely made mistakes. He said he put together a horrible offensive staff that didn't help his quarterbacks develop, didn't help anybody on the offensive side of the ball develop. He's excited about what Kendall Browse is going to bring them. He's excited about how James Blackman is throwing the ball. And I think he's excited more than anything, and he's got guys now almost complete buy-in there. And that's what he didn't have initially. He did not have that buy-in. He had guys complaining every single week. Why do we got to do this? Why do we got to do that? You know, we did it the way it was before, and we won a lot of games. Why are we doing it this way? And you can't coach a team like that. You can't win games like that. You can't even put a team on the field like that without having significant problems and really fundamental problems. When guys are not bought in, when they don't care, when they're just getting through games and getting through practices, you know, a lot of bad things happen. And I think that's where he was last year.